we get started here. One of the most important meetings of the 20th century transpired when Malcolm Cecil here introduced Stevie Wonder to the synthesizer. Memorial Day weekend, 1971. He's once ranked as the number three bass player in London, and also as a radar man helped pilots land in bad weather. Malcolm Cecil has produced my favorite Isley Brothers song. He's worked with Muhammad Ali, Cheech and Chong, Miles Davis, and the Star Trek Enterprise. He designed the first polyphonic multitimbral synthesizer to occupy a little bit over 800 square feet, and at one point it occupied the entirety of Stevie Wonder's brain. The synth is named TONTO, and this is Malcolm Cecil. Please welcome. So I figure we should start with one of the Boeing bass lines, one of the more famous ones that you're known for, the little Stevie Wonder.
Synthesizer equipment, mainly Moog equipment, that was all we had at the beginning. And it was a very auspicious beginning because he came on that particular very, very hot day, and he came to the door and rang the bell. I lived on the third floor over Media Sound Studios where I was chief engineer. And they kept me, the apartment was thrown in as part of the gig because they wanted me on call 24/7, so that was part of the deal. But of course, we were mainly doing adverts. It was an advertising studio. We were trying to get record work. I was trying to get people in, but it was really mainly advertising. Madison Avenue, which means 1 hour sessions, 1 hour of strings, then they would leave. The horns would come in, an hour of horns, they would leave. Violin, the percussions would come in, whatever the instruments were. And the Moog was at that time not being used musically. It was a sound effects machine, making swooshing and whooshing sounds for things like Ford Torino. Those types of things. It was an effects machine. Nobody thought of it as a musical instrument because it only played one note at a time, even though there was a keyboard. And whenever a keyboard player would come in, they'd put a chord down and they'd lift their hands up immediately and say, "This thing is broken." You say, "No, that's the way it works." If you were a saxophone player or a trumpet player, you would only play one note and it would take your whole body to do it. So, one note, that's all you get. That's the way the machine works. Most people were not comfortable with that, particularly piano players, because that's not the way they think. So it was sort of a bit unfortunate that the interface to the Moog synthesizer at that time was a keyboard. The other unfortunate part was that the keyboard would not stay in tune for more than two octaves. So there was a tuning problem. And this, I'm familiar with tuning problems because being an upright bass player, contrabass, okay, there's no frets, you have to find the right tuning. So it's all about sensing where it is. Anybody here plays a stringed instrument knows exactly what I mean. It takes a lot of practice to play in tune. So I was used to moving my fingers very, very minutely to go in tune and listening and tuning. My ear, hand coordination was very good. So I came up with a solution, which was to take an aeroplane controller. Have you ever seen that? A joystick controller from an aeroplane, modern aeroplane? It goes left, right, and up and down. And it's sprung so that in both directions it always comes to the center. So I took off the springs in the vertical direction, but left them on in the horizontal direction. And I connected the horizontal control to, I created a voltage and plugged it into the oscillators. And when I turned it up, it would go increase the pitch, turn it down, it would decrease the pitch. You could bend notes with it, which was nice. And you could also make a sort of vibrato by waggling the stick. But the other thing that was missing was there was no such thing as velocity sensitivity. We're all used to it now with MIDI. We know that touch is very important. And so music goes back a long way. Organs have been around for 2,500 years. The first organs were by the Romans. There are evidence in the lava stream of Pompeii that the organs, they had organ competitions, the Romans had. And there's a brass plate that was retrieved from the lava after Vesuvius erupted, and it destroyed everything in its path, including this big organ. There were water organs. There was a chamber in the bottom that was full of air, and then there was another chamber at the top that the player sat on, and there was a hole between the two. They would fill the top one with water, and then the valves would be connected, the bottom chamber would be connected to the pipes, which were probably wood, we don't know, because they were destroyed, but the fact that they weren't metal, they would not have been destroyed if they were metal, because the brass plate was still there that said that this was an organ that had won a competition 250 years before the birth of Christ. So most people don't realize the organ's that old. How they played it, we don't really know, but they did have some sort of valve. And when you pulled the valve open, the water would descend and pressure would come up and it would play the notes. Low pressure, but so long as there was water in the upper chamber to go through, you didn't have to pump it or anything. And that was, the Romans were very good water engineers. They were. They had aqueducts, they were very, very conscious of water and its importance, so they were very good hydraulic engineers. And this was basically the way that they all worked. Anyhow, the organ has one problem, which is also the same problem that the harpsichord has. Again, no touch sensitivity. You push the harpsichord note down with a little, it just comes to a certain point and fires off this quill, which goes up, twangs the string. It doesn't matter whether you hit it like this or whether you hit it like this. It's always the same level, always the same volume. Organ, the same. You push out any note, it's always the same, unless you use the foot pedals to change, but then all the notes change the same. So you don't have independent control. And it wasn't until 300 years ago when the piano came around and was invented, the double escapement, they call it, which enabled the hammer to be thrown at a different velocity, depending upon how hard you hit the key. All of a sudden, touch sensitivity became part of music. Prior to that, it would have been the Baroque period, where if you wanted to, you listened to Bach and everything, switched on Bach, okay, was the first big popular record. Why? Because the Moog synthesizer was totally suited to Bach, because Bach's music was written for organ and harpsichord, which had no touch sensitivity. So the way they got around that was with ornamentation. Okay, instead of this ornamentation was the way they got around the idea that they didn't have any touch sensitivity. Now, it didn't apply to horns and stringed instruments. They've always had sensitivity in that direction. But the keyboard instruments, until the invention of the piano, were not velocity sensitive, were not sensitive to touch. And this changed the music, and it gave birth to the classical era, which came immediately after the Baroque era. It was only 50 years of classical. People talk about classical music, but the actual classical period was only 50 years. And the music changed because of the invention of this instrument that was able to be touch sensitive. Now, first, the pianos were wood frame, and so they couldn't be they weren't so loud, the tension couldn't be up so high, and so they were very soft, relatively speaking, compared to today's pianos. And the strings were not they were not manufactured of the same materials. So the pianos, if you ever go to get a chance to play a piano that's more than 300 years old, there's a few of them around, you'll see what I mean. They're very, very quiet compared to modern pianos, and also the pitches are. So when modern piano came out, we had this wonderful new form of music where now we were able to play with touch sensitivity. But I wanted to do that with the synthesizer. So I decided, most important thing, how do we do that? How do we get it in? So that was what the vertical part of the controller was. And the reason I took the springs off was because I wanted to be able to move it and leave it where it was, so I could put it onto the filter. Now, when we do voltage control, we have what we call the classic patch. The classic patch is sound source filter, which takes the complex waveform from the oscillator and takes away, it's called subtractive synthesis, because it removes harmonics. And then we cut it on and off with a thing we call a voltage-controlled amplifier, which is in turn controlled by a thing called an envelope generator, which generates the shape of the actual note. Not the frequency inside, but it's the envelope. It's that which is just like an envelope for a letter. The note, the letter is the note. The envelope is the shape of it. So this was the classic patch. And what I did was I took the vertical and put it to the filter. And what this did was when I pulled the filter down, it muted out the higher harmonics, which was the same as sort of like happens when you do touch sensitivity. In fact, it's a much better thing. Many MIDI instruments have got the velocity going to volume. Not good. You want the velocity going to filtration. You want to bring down the high frequencies when you are soft, and when you get louder, you want much harder. The other thing is, of course, it should be voltage controlled envelope generators, which Bob Moog never did invent, never did make ever. And I tried many times to get voltage-controlled oscillators, many manufacturers to make them, because I'm not in the manufacturing business, so I give my ideas away, hoping that other manufacturers will actually make them so I can use them. So this is how I was able, with just the joystick, I was able to do two things. The first thing was to control the pitch. Now, remember I told you only two octaves in tune? But on the control, do we have the picture of the control?
Yes.
I have a picture here which I can demonstrate what I'm talking about when it comes on. You'll find it in a minute. Basically, what it is not only is there the joystick, but there are two little knobs on either side which adjust the position of the potentiometers physically so that you can zero it. When you're flying a model aircraft, you have to, what they call, trim it. You have to, and so the center zero has to be adjusted vertically and horizontally. And this is a little thing, and I used to put my little finger on that so that when the notes went high, I could sharpen it slightly because it always went flat at the top. And with my little finger, and then as the notes went lower, I could come back to the middle and then use the actual joystick as a bender to make, you know, to bend sounds, you know, to get all that emotional effect. And then vertical gave me the equivalent of touch sensitivity. Now, I'm a bass player, jazz bass player. That was the first thing I really did in professional music. And so I'm used to watching piano players and getting whatever clues I can of where their chords are going to be, what they do, by watching their left hand particularly, but by watching and seeing where, you know, what they're doing, and that gives me a clue as, oh, he's playing that chord, okay, I can go to it. And this was how I performed in jazz. So it was no big jump for me to watch Stevie's left hand, or because he, whatever he was playing, and learn the line.
Oh, sorry.
Yes, sorry. I could learn the line because we would play it over and over. The lines were usually simple.
We have a frozen laptop here, folks. Apologize for the delay.
Well, we can manage without that. Anyhow, I don't know how many people are following me because I understand, you know, this is not the language I'm speaking. I wish I understood Russian. anyway, it's. I should maybe. Am I talking too fast for people? Okay, so let me know if I'm going too fast or getting too complicated, because I don't want to lose you. Anyhow, so I would watch Stevie and learn the line pretty much. I could hear it. I could pretty well respond because of my jazz experience immediately anyway, but I was able to see what he was doing and get the feel of what he wanted, and I was able to do the touch sensitivity. He was playing the notes, no question about that. He played all the notes, but I was able to bend them into get the little bends that were needed in the right places, and to turn the portamento on and off so that the notes would go boom wee instead of bop bop. Okay, portamento is a slide, and so we were able to work as a team. And my musical partner, Bob Margolf, would be controlling knobs and changing other parameters while we were playing. So the three of us played the line. It only became real when the three of us played. It took all three. It was like three people playing one instrument. And that was how we started. That was the key ingredient to all the music that we made, because it wouldn't work with just one person doing it. There's too many things that needed controlling. And we worked as a team, and we also didn't have any other engineers. We did all the recording, we did all the mixing. There were three of us in the studio for the first two albums. And then, of course, when things got popular, then the hordes descended And the studio filled up with all sorts of people who are necessary but were trying to become necessary. And things got to a point where I personally couldn't continue working after the fourth album. I just said, sayonara, we'll see you later. I have an album, another Tonto album to make. I went off and we split up, Stevie went his way, and Bob and I split, because Bob didn't want to be involved with Tonto anymore. He felt that it was, he wanted to be a producer. And things that were technical, we're trying to create music that had validity and had a feeling and soul, which is the most important thing in Stevie's music, is soulful music. It's very felt, and I can identify with that. And we worked very well as a team for those four albums that we made, which was Music of My Mind, Talking Book, Inner Visions, where we all got Grammys. I even got a Grammy for that. And then there was Fulfilling This First Finale, which the title speaks for itself. Because the fulfillingness was Tonto, and fulfillingness was going away. So Stevie had bought himself his own synthesizers, and he figured he could do it on his own, so we said, fine, do it. There were so many people coming to us to record. We had the Isley Brothers came, the Doobie Brothers, and then there was Joe Baez, countless artists that would come and spend maybe two or three days with us. Weather Report came and spent time on the Tailspinning album. And we were on album after album because nobody else had the ability to say to the artist, yes, we can do this in a reasonable time, we can play it in tune, we can keep the instrument in tune for you, we will work with you, and it's not going to take 3 days to do a track, as it otherwise would, because programming in those days took a long time. But we were fair about it, we did everything in reasonable time. It only took us maybe 2 hours to get a sound instead of 2 days. And this was important because budget. Studio time is expensive those days. And studio time has really gone down in price over the years. Back then it was much higher. And records were $100,000 was a small budget. And that was the reason why we had to keep everything very, very condensed and keep the time short. And people didn't have time for tuning the instrument. So it was a very practical approach.
Maybe we should listen to a track from the Tonto's expanding headband, give people an idea of the music you were working on. So Stevie showed up at the studio, he had a copy of the album with him, did he not?
When Stevie showed up on that first day, he had a copy of Zero Time on his arm. And it was Memorial Day weekend. The studio was closed because it was an advertising studio. And of course, as chief engineer of the studio, I had the keys. So Stevie showed up and said he wanted to see Tonto. And I said, we'll take you downstairs. What he meant is he wanted to put his hands on. See, and the first question was, is it a keyboard instrument? And I sort of hedged a bit and said, well, yes, sort of. I didn't want to put him off and tell him that the keyboard had problems. So from day one, we started down there. The first weekend, by Monday of that week, we had 17 songs recorded. Not complete, but 17 basic tracks started. We had Tonto on every one of them, except one. Well, I was playing bass with Stevie, and because he heard I was a bass player. So, you play bass, so we started off. And the first song we played, it was all right, but second song he played, I'm playing bass, and I said to him, this isn't the right sound. This is taking it to a jazz place. It's not where the music belongs. We need to have a sound on the synthesizer. So he says, can we do that? So we did, and we never looked back from that moment. And one of the songs we recorded that weekend was Evil, which is one of my favorite songs of Steve's. It goes from key to key. It changes up and forth every few bars. That, another one, Golden Lady, goes up a semitone into the chorus. Stevie liked to experiment, and we used to talk a lot about harmony. One of my hobbies is harmonics and harmony. I've got a whole bunch of theory about that. And I would sit down at the piano and play a few changes, and Stevie would go, what's that? And I'd explain to him what it was. He had a very unusual technique. He played flat-fingered. And this was because of his unsightedness, because he couldn't see, he didn't know how. And he used his thumbs to find the registration where he was. And so I used to tell him, hey Stevie, you play prejudiced piano. You just play on the black notes. Because that was how everything of Stevie's, if you listen to the record, it's all on the black notes. Everything is either an E-flat minor or a G-flat or a D-flat. It's all predominantly black notes. Because that was easier for him to play on. And he, when he plays the clavinet, he doesn't really play the notes. He pats it in this sort of fashion. I have to laugh when I see on YouTube all these people say, oh, this is how to play the superstition clavinet part. Superstition clavinet part lets you into a secret. Superstition clavinet part was played into a tape loop while Stevie was listening. We had tape delay, which I had. He put down the drum track first, which was unusual. Normally we would put down a vocal and some keyboard. But this time he put down a drum track first. And I timed the slap to be a triplet of the drum track, so it would swing, because triplets swing. The triplets create, it's to do with harmonics and stuff, so don't get me into that. I'll talk for 5 minutes. Anyhow, he basically, he got the idea really, really quickly. And we ended up doing these, the tracks were all done in a unique fashion. But he started off with this patting on the clavinet, he was listening to the slap at the same time, the headphones, and we were recording it. So what he's playing is, he's playing, if you do slap with a triplet, if you play, if you go dum, dum, if you play two against three, it's a very, very common rhythm. It's basis of African music, it's basis of jazz. Two against three, it goes dum, ticky, da, dum, ticky, da, dum, ticky, da, dum. That's the sort of basic rhythm. And if you set up a triplet and then you play across it in two, so the slap is going da, 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 you go dum, 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 dum. You know what you get if you play a scale? Goes it just does. Try it. Anyhow, so Stevie was only playing little pat things, and the triplet things were coming back. And there's these people on YouTube trying to say, oh, this is how you play it. Trying to finger this thing. Makes me laugh. But it's much simpler than that. We went for very simple solutions to what people thought were complex problems. Sure, superstition.
I don't have it on here.
We don't have it.
We can all sing it.
You can get it on YouTube, but and you can also see the whole conversation on YouTube about people doing it.
should we play the River Song from the original?
Oh yeah, from TONTO's Expanding Hip Hop.
Yeah.
River Song is the first speech synthesis attempt. In fact, the only speech synthesis attempt, because. As David well knows here, David has written a book on vocoders, and that's how we first met. He interviewed me for this book.
Yeah, you told me that we exist in a nine-dimensional universe,
This is true.
All right. We're on our way. And I was thinking in terms of this song called River Song. And it's interesting because last night Andrei Smirnov told us about an inventor from Petrograd named Evgeny Shulko, inventor of the variophone. In 1917, Mr. Shulko wrote a science fiction story called The Enemy of Music. He describes a machine capable of synthesizing any sound using oscillators based on a tuning fork, and he called it the mechanical orchestra. So Malcolm and I thought, TONTO lives. So this is River Song, and there's some Tai Chi involved, possibly.
Well, River Song, the words are basically the only way out of a circle is through the center. Leap into stillness, grasp with open hand. Heaven lies close upon earth, where an endless stream flows forth, embracing. It's all about Tai Chi. It's all about, those of you who don't know what Tai Chi is, Tai Chi is an ancient Chinese art of longevity and self-defense. It can be used, it's devastating if used incorrectly by an experienced practitioner. But it's not something you can learn in 5 minutes. It takes years. I've been doing it now 43 years, and I consider it the reason why at 76, I'm reasonably active and young. I was here till 2:30 last night, probably be here till 2:30 tonight. I can usually outlast most people in the studio, half my age, or even less. So anyway, I attribute all this to Tai Chi. And it's also an interesting other factor here is there's two things about this. You'll hear the bells in this piece are actually Russian bells. What do I mean by that? Well, we were trying to synthesize a bell sound, and we got the clem. The only way is out of a circle is coming next. It's through the center. That's a Russian bell. Anybody reckon? Anybody here from Kiev? Okay, well, in Helmholtz's, Heinrich Helmholtz was a fantastic, eclectic scientist in the 18th century, 19th century, 1840, 1850. He toured all around Europe, and he was an eclectic. He was a doctor. He invented the ophthalmoscope, which is that circular mirror with a hole in the middle. Do they use that over here with the doctor looks at your eye? Maybe not. Anyway, he invented that. He was a glass blower, and he created the Helmholtz resonator, which is a spherical piece of glass with two holes. One that you point outwards, the other you put to your ear. It only has one frequency of resonance. And so he used to use this to analyze the harmonics of various sounds. And he traveled all over Europe with a whole set of these Helmholtz resonators in a big case. And of course, he was traveling in a horse and cart. He analyzed the sounds, and he went to Kiev and he analyzed the sound of the Great Bell of Kiev, and he put down the harmonics, he wrote them down in his book. And I remembered reading about this when I was a very young man in college, and somewhere I thought, well, didn't he analyze the Great Bell of Kiev? So I went to my library, pulled out the Helmholtz book, looked at what the harmonics were, and it turns out that the harmonics were the square of every natural number. That's the fundamental one. 2 squared is 4, so the fourth harmonic. 3 squared is 9, so the ninth harmonic. 4 squared is 16, so the 16th harmonic. 5 squared is 25, so on. We had enough oscillators to make 8 of these harmonics. So we tuned the harmonics up to what Helmholtz had said would be the harmonics of the Great Bell of Kiev. And we'd already got the envelope, the clang. That was easy. that was just the envelope just kind of hung. That was easy. The sound was not a bell. We could make it sound like a bell. When we dialed those harmonics in, hit the key, and there was this great bell of key came out of the speakers. And Bob and I were dancing around the studio. We did it, good old Helmholtz, we did it. So Helmholtz lived, and the great bell of Kiev, the sound of the great bell of Kiev is on this track. That's the first interesting thing. The second interesting thing is you notice how the melody moves. It doesn't sound like any scale you've really heard in the West. It sounds more Middle Eastern, you notice this? Okay, there's an example of it. The twists and the... You know why? Because it's not in 12-tone scale. It's in 17-tone scale. I tuned on the synthesizer from C to F as an octave. And then I learned to play. And you play it, it's third tones. So it goes, if you're going from C, it goes C is the first note. E flat is the next note, okay? Then G flat's like a diminished chord. Then you go semitone to G, and now you do another diminished. And now it's the end of the scale. You can play diatonically, but in between you have third tones. And I didn't know at the time, but I found out some years later, that this is the scale that they use in the Middle East. It's a 17-tone scale, it's an Arabian scale. I had no idea when we did it, but that was what it is. But this is how it came out. And this is how, again, very simple solutions to what people might consider difficult problems. But it worked for us, and this created a feel that you hear on this particular piece.
I like how river bass, right? River song has a nice bottom to it as well.
The Tonto is famous for its bass sounds because I'm a bass player. That's where I gravitated to. And, you know, as an upright bass player, acoustic, oh, this is a roar.
Yeah.
This was the first piece that we did. We weren't making music for a record. This was experimental music, try and find out what would work on the instrument, what wouldn't. This piece was originally 27 minutes long, and we edited it down to 7 minutes in the end. And it's like primal music. This is like the birth of the universe. This is sort of what we had in mind with this piece. And it's called Aurora. Strangely enough, I'm staying in the Hotel Aurora here. So everything seems to come in big circles, and there's some very interesting spiritual things, I think, that go on in life that most of us ignore. But I think spirituality is a very, very important part of music. It's what music is not so much a universal language as it is universal. Also, there is no center of the brain that is for music. There's a visual center, and there's a speech center, but the whole brain lights up if you look on an MRI when you play music to people. And people respond to music whether they are super high intellectual people like Einstein, he was a violin player, he was very musical, or whether they're autistic and have some defect in the brain. But every person responds to music. There is no culture in the world that does not have its music. Every culture. So music is not a universal language. It is universal, period. So this is the importance of music, is to convey emotion, is to convey spiritual ideas. This is why the church used music throughout the early part of music history in the West. In the medieval days, it was the church that was music because spiritual. And they were making music. The audience was not supposed to be other people, although really music is something, sounds that are made for people, to other people to listen to. But the real audience for church music was the deity, was God. So this is always been. So spirituality is important, feeling is important, emotion is important, but just as important today as it has ever been. And it's the thing that is most lacking in modern instruments, because with the digital instruments, one of the things I was asked last night, somebody asked me a question here privately, they were saying, what's the difference between, do I notice the difference between analog and digital? And my answer was, yes, I do, because digital, always the same. No matter what note you play, it's always the same. Always, always, always the same. It's both, it's the blessing and the curse. The blessing in that very quick, push the button, there's the sound. Okay? But the curse is, it's always the same. It's boring. And even during a song, it's boring, so you have to find some way to change it. And so that's where velocity sensitivity comes in, and aftertouch, and reprogramming your MIDI synthesizers so that you're not doing things like controlling volume with velocity, but you're controlling timbre with velocity. That's much more real. Or you're controlling attack time with velocity. That's much more real. It's much more like what happens with real instruments.
So we're going, we're jumping back a little bit, because this is somewhat major impact on you in your life. And you can't quite see the Nova chord that she used to play, but I think you used to play with the knobs and were up to a little bit of mischief during her performances growing up.
Well, my mother, as you can see, she was a multi-instrumentalist. You can't see the violin down here. This is her publicity picture. There's a violin, also, she was a fantastic violinist. Accordion, she was known as the Queen of the Accordion in England before I was born. And I've always been in a musical environment all my life. She used to play during the Second World War, because I was born in 1937, so by the time it was 1943, 1944, I was 5, 6 years old, and she used to take me on the job with her. And the job that she had at the time was she had an orchestra. They used to play every Sunday afternoon in Covent Garden Opera House, which had been converted into a dance hall. They put wood over the seats, dance floor over the seats. They kept the stage, but they kept dance floor over the and it was mainly for the American servicemen who were, you know, dancing was the big thing in the 30s and the 40s. And it was the way the sexes interacted. That was what was the attraction. It wasn't the music, it was getting together with the opposite sex, which is always a driving force, music. So this, because there were no men, able-bodied men, they were all called up into the service. They were all fighting the Nazis during the Second World War, as you were here too. And the issue became, how do we have dance bands? So my mother had an all-girls dance band. And on Sunday afternoons, she would play at Covent Garden Opera House. And they had a circular stage, which rotated. And so the band would be on, and then when it was time for the band to take a break, my mother would climb up to the very top, and at the very top there was this new instrument that was only 3 or 4 years before the outbreak of war that they had obtained it for the opera house, called the Nova chord, made by Hammond. It was the very first instrument that had any it was the forerunner of the voltage-controlled synthesizer. And it was a very unique instrument, and my mother was able to play it. She was very, very good. And so when the band took a break, she would go up and she would play in the break on this Nova chord. And she used to let me come and sit next to her. And my job was to move the music and bring the next piece of music up, put it on for her. And I was her librarian, you know. And she would show me little knobs on the thing. I'd say, well, why is this different to the piano? And she'd say, oh, because if you turn this knob, if you go here, look, it goes very loud. And what it was the attack time. So when she turned the attack all the way to the left, it was like immediate, bum, 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 very percussive. But then she turned it to the right more, and then it was more like a string instrument. Okay. So being a little kid, my mother was bending down to get some music. I thought I'd play a trick on her. So the knob is all the way to the left, so I turn it all the way to the right, all the way to the right. Okay. So my mother puts the music up, goes up, puts her hands on the keys, nothing happens, right? A very, very slow attack time, right? She looks at me, what did you do? And I sheepishly point to the knob. And she puts the knob back to where it's supposed to be. She says, you are a naughty boy. You can't sit next to me anymore. You're banned. You have to go now, and you go into the lighting box. This was supposed to be a punishment. So I was introduced to synthesis pretty early.
Here we have, how old were you in this picture?
This is 9th July, it says on the bottom here, July 1953. I'm what, 16 years old? And you can see I'm very into nerdy. The artist is a young nerd.
Important to start early.
This is me playing with Roland Kirk at Ronnie Scott's club. Ronnie Stevenson on drums. You notice the cigarette? That was very cool in those days. And Stan Tracy on piano. That's me with the beard.
I like the beard.
And incidentally, that bass there, I still own it. It's the same bass that I've had since I was 21. It's a fantastic instrument, 250 years old. So I'm very proud of that instrument.
I like the story you told me about how one day you liked to play the bass in utter darkness during a TONTO show. Just shut everything down.
Oh yeah, I had a fantasy that one day, TONTO, we always plan to use TONTO live. And we have done some live performances, but not quite as successfully as we might have done. So with TONTO, we decided,
you were talking about it'd be great to perform with TONTO.
Excuse me. We're talking about the bass thing, right. Lost the thread for a second there. Age is what it is. I put it that way. Anyhow, the idea was to have a live performance with TONTO, and then all of a sudden, in the middle of something, everything goes black. All the exit lights, everything. Like there's been a power cut. And then it's like silence for a minute, and then you hear this bass playing. Okay? Because when it comes down to it, you know, four strings and a piece of wood, that's all you need. You don't need anything else. Music is music, and you can make it any way you wish, but there's always been a fantasy of mine to sort of do that, because it probably never happened.
some other artists, while working with Stevie Wonder and afterwards, you had some other pretty good clientele.
The Isley Brothers.
I think you created one of my favorite phase moments on record. Who's that lady?
Thank you.
brothers.
Ernie Isley on guitar. The Isley brothers used to have a guitar player by the name of Jimi Hendrix. And young Ernie Isley was 9 years old when he was allowed backstage with his brothers. And apparently he was totally fascinated with Jimmy's playing on the guitar. And he told Jimmy he wanted to learn guitar. And Ernie is a very serious young man, very serious. Even at nine, he was serious. And he basically was, he would watch Jimmy intently every night. And Jimmy would show him chords and show him things. And he would say, Jimmy told him, one day you'll be playing with your brothers. And Ernie was like totally into that. And he tried to learn everything off of Jimmy he could. And after Jimmy passed away, when the Isleys came to me, there was a fellow called Roger Mayer, who I had met in England as a young, when in my 16-year-old days, when I used to frequent the surplus electronic stores for war surplus bits and pieces to make my little projects with. I used to run into this other young guy about the same age as me called Roger Mayer. And we would sort of like talk about, oh, did you see that thing over there? What would you use that for? We'd discuss these things. Well, later it turns out that he was the one who made the Octavia box for Jimi Hendrix, and also who tuned his guitar. He was Jimi Hendrix's guitar tech, and he not only tuned his guitars, but he set them up and everything. So when Ernie came to me and asked us, said, I want to get sound like Jimmy. I can't seem to get it in any way. I don't know. He had a box. And I said, well, I know who built the box. Let's go and see him. And I took Ernie over to see Roger, and Roger built a box identical for Ernie, and also took his Stratocaster and set it up the way he had for Jimmy, and Ernie's never looked back. That was his big inspiration. Ernie, of course, no longer with us.
Yeah, you had an encounter with Hendrix's manager, I believe, who could have been a part of the British Secret Service.
Oh yes, when I was in the Royal Air Force, I spent some time, I won't go into the details, but basically my wife and I ended up sharing a flat with a gentleman called Mike Jeffries, who we became partners in a club called the Downbeat Club, a jazz club in Newcastle-on-Tyne, which opened on the same day that Ronnie Scott's jazz club opened in London. I believe the Downbeat is still going. Anyway, about two or three months into the club's formation, this was in Newcastle-on-Tyne, 300 miles north of London, of course, out of reach from my point of view of the jazz clubs. I couldn't be playing down there. Mike Jeffries said to me one day, he said, how would you like to get a posting down to within 30 miles of London? I said, it'd be great, but it's never going to happen. He said, well, I might be able to arrange it if you sell me your share in the club. I said, well, if you can arrange it, I'll sell you my share, no problem, because it's more important for me to get down to London and play in the clubs where I've been playing before, because I've been playing in the jazz club since I was 15. So this time I was 21. So I didn't believe he could do it. He said, oh yes, I can do it. And he took me into his bedroom, and he took me to the wardrobe. My wife was there too. And he opened the wardrobe and took out a uniform. And it said, British Intelligence. And it was a major insignia on there. I said, oh, it's not your uniform. He says, oh, yes, it is. He says, I'm a major in British Intelligence, which is MI6. It's super, super high up stuff. And I'm, well, yeah, right. You got this at a fancy dress store, right? Well, it's not yours. So he said, oh, we'll see. So 3 weeks later, I get posted to within 30 miles of London. And he comes to me and he says, you see, I told you I could do it. Now you have to sell me your half of the club. So I did. Moved down to London and didn't meet Matt Jeffries again until we moved Tonto to Electric Lady in New York City with Stevie to the beginning of Talking Book. When we started making Talking Book, we moved from Media Sound to Electric Lady, because it was difficult for me to stay at Media Sound. Having been the chief technical engineer there, all of a sudden now I'm its major client for the record stuff. We were there, we were booking the room out by the week. So there were too much problems for management and the other engineers, and we decided we had to move to another studio where we could just be clients and not have any of the other political stuff get in the way. So that was the situation with Mike. He was running Electric Lady at the time, because Jimmy had died, and he was running the whole studio. So we moved in there, we were there for about a year, and then we went to Los Angeles, and went to the record plant.
In Los Angeles, you had the Doobie Brothers, and the bass player, Skunk Baxter, turned out to be a missile defense consultant. Interesting second career for him. But you worked on this amazing Doobie Brothers album, The Captain and Me. And in preparing to fly to Moscow for the first time, I figured the best thing for me to do is to listen to the Doobie Brothers. Lost a bridge in California. That's the 10-minute disco version. I kind of wanted to bump it up a little bit. And then another Doobie Brothers track real quick. Whoops.
Every week, and Billy had one of these hosting things, and he invited us to bring TONTO along. And we had, there were four people playing. The fellow on the left up there is playing drums, but they're synth drums, they're Moog drums that we hooked in. The fellow in the red is Robert Margoleff. Billy is in the middle, I'm the guy in the brown, and the guy is him. And so there's the four of us all playing the instrument simultaneously. I don't have the track for that here, but this is just a still photograph from that particular session. And if you can go on iTunes and look for TONTO's Expanding Headband, Bittersweet, and that was what we were playing.
Would you say this is TONTO's first television debut, or would it be this? No, this is in the theater. I mean, it's amazing you have a synthesizer that makes a cameo in a musical directed by Brian De Palma. This is from Phantom of Paradise, and that's the Phantom. What's going on up there?
Well, this was a bit of a bittersweet experience. One day we showed up at Record Plant, Robert and I, to go into Studio B unexpectedly. We weren't booked in, but the studio had been built for Stevie and I, been completely refurbished. And we had TONTO in the back of the studio itself, in the isolation booth. And you can see, you can't really see it in this particular photograph, but it had its own speakers and the whole thing in there. And normally it was locked up, nobody could get to it. And we walked in and they tried to stop us getting into the room. And we couldn't figure out, what's going on? Is the recording going on? I thought that this was our, we walk in there and they're filming TONTO. They hadn't even told us they were going to do it. The guy from Record Plant, Chris Stone, had rented it out to them without even telling us, thought he was going to get away with it. Anyway, we got a contract with them that was supposed to be, whenever TONTO appeared in the movie, it was supposed to have the TONTO track there. Of course, they never honored that. You've got to see the movie, there's just piano underneath it. Well,
could have been Paul Williams.
Oh, it was.
Yeah. So here's another good TONTO cameo on the cover album, Gil Scott-Heron, 1980.
Yeah, this was Gil Scott-Heron and I had a very long relationship, which started in 1978 with Bridges and went on all the way up to his recent demise. And we released something like 20 albums over that period. Gil and I got on very well. Gil was very politically active, and he was also a very, very interesting person. He was, he had a rapier-like wit. You could never win with him verbally. Most people don't realize it, but he was a doctor of English literature. He's a professor at Johns Hopkins University, which is where he met Brian Jackson. And Brian Jackson was a music professor there. And they used to sneak out at after hours, and they used to break into this chapel where there was a piano. And Gil, who was tall, Brian is fairly small and slender, as you can see, relative to Gil. Gil's like a long string bean, 6'3" or something. And Brian used to get up on Gil's shoulders and climb through the window and then go around and open the door and let Gil in. They used to play through the night there on this, the only decent piano on campus.
So we should listen to a track. This is 1980, a little bit of vocoder bias here as well. 1980. So we're running out of time here, and I want you to show your TONTO interface.
Oh yeah, sure. We have a little surprise for everybody here. I'm developing something for TONTO because I think everybody should have an opportunity to have a little TONTO in their life. So I have decided that we're going to make what we call virtual TONTO. And we've made a start on it. And the start, I will show you what we have here. We need to plug this thing in. And I hope the video doesn't, this video side of it works.
This is exciting, we can all basically enter TONTO. Yeah,
let's see now. Did it come up? Nope, it's not there. Oh boy.
Oh, technology.
Technology will always make you look stupid. Now, I have to...
I'm living proof.
Take me 2 seconds here. I know what I have to do. I have to go to applications. This is a little lesson. No, not desktop. Applications, please. Thank you. And then we go down to... What is it? System...
TONTO and try out the different sounds. I think it's going to be a way to keep the TONTO legacy alive. While you're listening to your Stevie Wonder records, or Gil Scott-Aaron, or the Doobies.
Success! Nothing like success. Okay. That's the back of the rack that contains this module. And if we want to actually look at, for example, this guy here, we can go in and we can zoom in. And we can move it around. So you can see here, this is a 2500 filter. And you can see there's a little handwriting on there. We can go back and reset this, come out, and we can do this with any of the modules. If I go back out here, I can move around in this little thing. We can do it to any of the modules. We can get on there. This is just the beginning. This is just the user interface where we're able to. There's different sections of TONTO here. Here are the trunk bolts and unique wave. That's the plugs on the back. So we can go in and we can see, you know, if you want to look at any of the modules, we can do so. And the idea is that we'll go from here, we make this so that it's not just lookable, but it's patchable and playable. And the idea would be that you buy the case, TONTO itself, for a very reasonable price in software as an app, and you can then populate it with any of the modules that you choose. And then the modules will be patchable, and you'll actually be able to play TONTO, or the virtual TONTO, as we should call it. So that's the plan.
Sounds like a good plan.
Well, we're going to pull it off.
Yeah.
This is just the beginning. This represents only 4 weeks of programming so far, and this is just the beginning.
Just 4 weeks.
This is 4 weeks of programming, but the whole instrument is that way. I mean, we have everything in there. There's every module, and you can move around from module to module in this little navigating thing at the bottom here, but you see, and you can see the back of TONTO. You can see that it's quite considerably. There's a lot of wiring involved, a lot of hardware, and so on. So there will never be another TONTO, but there will be, hopefully, many hundreds, maybe thousands, maybe tens of thousands of virtual TONTOs out there. So keep your eyes open for virtual TONTO coming soon. Please wait.
One Malcolm Cecil. Do we have time for questions, or should we? Any questions?
No, it's unrelated to the virtual TONTO, but the thing that. My mind for some time. Could you please tell about the project of Caldera Among Mass? Caldera Among Mass.
Oh, Caldera, yes, the Caldera Among Mass. That was one of the very first speech synthesis that we ever did. John Crigliano came to us and said he wanted to realize the Caldera Mass. In its full glory. It's a very old mass, and he wanted to do it in Latin, and he wanted us to do it with speech synthesis. So since it was Latin, it was fairly easy because nobody speaks Latin these days, so we can get away with murder. But that was how we started to get our speech synthesis technique together. It was during the Caldera, and many people, including David, asked me, well, how did you do the speech synthesis? And as I told him, you know, I could tell you how I did it, but then I'd have to shoot you.
I've got clearance.
No, there's some interesting things. Do you want to just...
I don't have it with me.
Oh, what a shame.
Top secret vocoder Bible, next time.
Yeah. David is the vocoder expert. None of this was vocoded, by the way. It was all done with synthesis techniques, followers, and a lot of simple tricks. Remember, I'm a simple man. I like things to be simple. Now, a lot of simple things, you add them together and you get a TONTO. But TONTO is, it's not complicated. In fact, in Spanish, TONTO means simple. People think it means stupid, but that's not true. It means simple. And TONTO is a lot of simple things put together And when you look at it in one level, it looks complicated. But really, it's not as complicated as it looks. Everything is there for a reason. And, you know, I could go on for hours and hours and hours, but we have to.
We have the great Peter Znoga next. Please stick around, and he's going to tell you about the future of music, basically. I'm looking forward.
Any other last questions?
Mr. Cecil, thanks for the amazing stories and the amazing music. The question is, what was your initial attitude towards crowd rock?
Towards which?
Crowd rock. You know, Tangerine Dream.
Kraftwerk, yes, okay.
They also, yeah.
I'm a believer that everybody has their place. Everybody has their voice. And just because there are more than one bass player, or more than one pianist, or more than one trumpet player, comparisons between people playing the same instrument, to me, it's odious. It's not the way. You can only compare yourself with yourself earlier. And I believe that.
Do you see any value in their music? Novelty?
I think so, yes. I think that people don't make music. I don't believe people make music for no reason. They make music because that's what they feel. And that's how, that's their voice in the world. And that's what they want to do. So if I listen to some music, and sometimes I don't get it at first, it's like, then probably I'm not listening properly. I'm not listening the way that the composer intended. And as time goes by, maybe I'll get it, maybe I'll like it, maybe I won't. But I think that everybody has their own place, everybody has validity. And you have to give other people their space. You have to let them be who they are. And you either appreciate it or you don't. And I think Kraftwerk do a good job. I like what they do. I think that they have a unique approach. And I applaud them sincerely. I think they're very, very well. They have a very well deserved place in the history of electronic music.
Thanks again, Malcolm Cecil.
Спасибо.